In the last couple of months, when COVID entered our lives and we were in a fix to deal with the situation, civil society organizations continued to fight the good battle on ground, from ensuring access to food for the underserved to ensuring continuity in education for the children. These social entrepreneurs have been the front runners in solving the challenges this crisis presented us with. Edumentum is fortunate to be working with some of these change leaders in the ecosystem. And through Aspire 2020, we bring you their stories and experiences. While these young change leaders work relentlessly towards solving the challenges in their spheres, we have ecosystem champions who have witnessed and have been active participants in bringing a change in the education system of India. I would like to begin the conference by inviting one such champion whose commitment to transforming education has brought about change in the lives of countless children. I'm talking about none other than Mr. S.D. Shibulal. Since 1990s, Mr. Shibulal and Ms. Kumari Shibulal started their philanthropic endeavors, and post that, their commitment to education has transpired innovation in the ecosystem like never before. Mr. S.D. Shibulal is the co-founder of Infosys and the trustee of the Shibulal Family Philanthropic Initiative. With his keen interest in improving education, he has supported several organizations across the country. He recognizes the need for change makers and believes in equipping them with technology and resources to further their cause for education. So without any further ado, I would like to invite Mr. Shibulal to open today's session by sharing his views on opportunities in the times of crisis, the way forward for civil society organizations. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, sir.
It's a great pleasure for me to be here. Thank you for inviting me to give this keynote address. So our journey with education started in 1999 when we were setting up the Shibulal Family Philanthropic Initiative, myself and Kumari. We were making a choice on which area to spend time on. And it was very evident to us very quickly that education is the field which we should choose. There are many reasons for it. Number one is the fact that whatever we did in our life, whatever Kumari and me did in our life, whatever we achieved, all that was from the benefit of the education which we got as young people. So our life happened because of the education which we received. There are many other reasons. Education, in my mind, is a great equalizer. In fact, it is probably the greatest equalizer. It is a potent enabler. It enables people . It's a passport to upward mobility in the society. And it is fundamental to creating an equitable society. It creates opportunities for the young people. It builds human capital. So it is all the more important to a country like India. And what we have seen over the last 20 years is that education is the cornerstone for development to break the cycle of poverty. So we decided to focus on education in 1999. We did a number of things over the years. We started out with a higher education program in 99, which have now grown into a larger endeavor. So we started working in the K-12 space. I've always said this, that our country is a country of contradictions. In any sector which we look, So on one hand, we produce 1 million engineers every year. But we have millions of children who are not in school. If you look at healthcare, for example, 70% of our doctors are in urban areas and 70% of the population is in the rural areas. I can go on and on these contradictions. Our gross enrollment ratio is now close to 85% in K-12 education. But by the time you go to higher education, it is 26%. Our aim for higher education actually was 30% by 2030. And now I think we have moved it in the new education policy, we have moved it to 35% by 2035. We will still be behind countries like China, which is at 43%, and US, which is at 86%. Of course, we have come in a very long way over the years. Our literacy rate today is 76% compared with 17% in 1950. So we have made significant improvements. We have come a long way in increasing the literacy levels over the years. Our education network is a very complex thing. We have 1.5 million schools, close to 200 million enrolled students, 4.5 million school leaders, 850 universities, and 40,000 higher education institutions in the country. So when RT was introduced in 2010, the purpose was to improve access to education. And I think after 2010, our gross enrollment ratios have gone up and we have improved access to education. But the quality of education, especially in the government schools and in the semi-private schools, deserve a lot. There are many challenges in this space. The size is a big challenge, 1.5 million schools. The teacher-student ratios are pretty bad when it comes to government schools. So if you look at a study done by Acer in 2019, in 26 rural districts, only 16% of class one students can read. And even class five students cannot read a class two textbook. The new education policy aims at improving the situation. It is aiming for 100% enrollment. It is aiming for increase in gross enrollment ratio in higher education. But more importantly, I think there is a focus on quality, which has come in. I think it's commonly accepted that while RT has improved the access to education, the quality of education deserves a lot. Of course, things have become much more complex given the COVID-19 pandemic. It has disrupted everyone's life, more importantly, the children's life. Governments across the world have shut down the operations. Schools are yet to open. In India also, millions of children are out of school. So, if you look at all these challenges, in many ways, we are, the most important need for us is to have change in the K-12 education. Right? There is enormous amount of improvements required, enormous amount of new thinking required, and major changes required in K-12 to increase the quality, at the same time making sure that the access continue to go up. All our experience, all my experience and all the experience of each and everyone on this team have taught us that change requires strong leadership. Leadership which is capable of making observations, identifying areas of change, implementing solutions, measuring impact, and creating a continuous cycle of improvement. As I said, this is a very complex, large, system, it is very hard for it to make quantum jumps in improvements, which means we need to build a cycle of continuous improvements. And that is possible only if we have strong leadership available in the education field. Hence the journey of Shiksha Logam. Shiksha Logam was started with a single objective: systemic improvement through leadership development. That was the single objective behind starting of Shiksha Logam. See, when I think about leadership, there are multiple aspects which comes to my mind. Number one is the role of the leaders. What is the role of a leader? In my mind, the leader's primary job is to raise the aspirations. Leader's job is to inspire. Leaders need to remain calm, confident, and focused, even in tough times, like what it is today. Of course, leaders need to identify change and create solutions, not create, co-create solutions along with the various stakeholders. They should be able to prioritize. They should be able to do ABC analysis, look at the high impact items, and put resources behind those changes. The way of a leader should not be autocratic. Autocratic solutions have a way of falling behind, falling by the wayside, even when they are the best solutions. Co-creation of solutions bring participation, buy-in, and a higher level of commitment by the stakeholders involved. So the first point, the role of the leaders is to create, is to inspire and to raise aspirations. The next important thing is the actions by the leaders. How does the leader act? First and foremost, the leader should walk the talk. The leader is the role model which people will look up to. The leader is the person whom others will imitate. Leaders need to be at the forefront of driving change. In many ways, the leader has to be the change. He is the first person to change so that others will believe in him and follow him, but should not be in the forefront of taking credit. Leader's job is to lead from the front, but not to be the one who is taking credit from the front. Leaders have to give visibility to others who are in the system, give credit to others, recognize and give credit to others. In many ways, a true leader will allow others to take the limelight while while leaders should get into details, leaders should not micromanage. The impact, measuring the impact, making sure that the effort is producing the required results or the expected results, in many ways, is the role of the leader. Leaders need to remain objective, unemotional in many ways, focus on data, and transaction-oriented. Right? They need to have the ability to close a transaction and move on. In my mind, every leader, no one is perfect. That means we need to continue to learn. Leader is no exception. They should have the ability to learn and self-correct. And most importantly, humble enough to accept mistakes. They should build a culture of collaboration and co-creation. because our problems are very complex and very large. To create solutions which are contextual, you need collaboration and co-creation. The third point which comes to my mind about the leader is the leader's beliefs. I believe a leader should be fair. More importantly, equally seen as fair. It is not only being fair, it is being seen as fair, honest, transparent, non-hierarchical in its approach. As I said, have an open mind to learn, willing to accept his own mistakes, and willing to roll up the sleeves and be in the trenches at times. So, as I said, the leader in many ways is the change maker. So it is with this single objective of enabling change makers within the system, Shiksha Logam was formed. Our journey so far has been very interesting. Of course, Shiksha Logam consists of three different components, three different layers. At the core, there is a digital infrastructure. On top of that, you have a co-creation collaboration layer and an amplification layer. As I said, the journey so far has been very fulfilling. Today, I think Shiksha Logam operates in 19 states, 4 states in full, 3.5 leaders enrolled, about 500 to 600 transactions per second. In many ways, our objective of developing leaders or driving systemic change in the K-12 education through leadership development has made a good beginning. Right, you have close to 4.5 million leaders in the system. So 3.2 lakhs is really not much. But I think we have made a good beginning. And when we look forward, the possibilities are infinite for collaboration and co-creation. With the emergence of the new normal after COVID, it is even more important to reinvent ourselves, and that requires leadership and our focus has been to build these leaders. So lastly, before I conclude, I want to congratulate all the attendees of cohort 2020 graduating today. I wish you all the best. I also welcome all of you into our fold. As change makers. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. We have a few questions for you now. So I'll just read out the questions. So the first question is, if you can share some views on inclusive education and how can we enable it?
So I think, as I said right in the beginning, education is the greatest enabler, greatest equalizer which you can bring to the table for every young person in this country. And it has to happen without prejudice. It has to happen without differentiation. It cannot be based on any kind of criteria. It has to be based on, it has to be based on true merit. Right? our experience with inclusive education is with our school, which is very interesting because probably we are the only school I know of where we have been able to bring together children from underserved communities and privileged communities. Now, this is pre-RTE. RTE happened in 2010. The school was started in 2000. The seeds of the school was done in 2004. And the school was started in 2007. So the integration happened before RTE. So when RTE came around, in many ways, it was easier for us. So our journey has been extremely fulfilling. So this year, last year, so we took children in 2004. When they were 3 years old and integrated them into a normal school in an inclusive manner. And the first two children, so we only took, we were very, this was an experiment to start with. Today we have a large number of children, but at that time it was an experiment to start with. And right now we have the first two children graduated last year and one of them topped the school.
Wow.
So that shows that, this whole nurture versus nature argument, it shows that given the right opportunities, and even this year, we have next year we'll have a lot more children because we took slow. And both children, one went to St. Joseph's, one has gone to Christ.
That's amazing, sir.
Amazing, right? These are children whom we took in 2005 when they're 3 years old, who stayed with us through this program and studied in an inclusive environment. It has its challenges. I'm not saying it is not, but it can be done. And I think that is where, again, leadership matters.
Yes, definitely. Thank you so much, sir. Another question is, what are the opportunities for collaboration for organizations in the current situation?
So actually, this is the situation where we need to collaborate. Anyway, today, you cannot go and meet anybody, right? Actually, one thing I really find funny, even though people, I think, seem to collaborate much better on Zoom rather than in a meeting. This is the feeling I get. But this is the time for us to collaboration. You see, we don't have the luxury of reinvention in this country. That we have to learn from each other. We have to, and Edmentum is a very good example of this whole philosophy, right? Edmentum is about learning from each other. It is not about us teaching all this. Edmentum is everything they need to know. They are actually learning from each other and continuing to collaborate, right? And it's a model in which while the invention happens in one part of one place, it is localized in the other place and contextualized by the Edmund who is in the other location, right? So it's a good example of collaboration and co-creation. Just because after this COVID, it is even more going to be challenging because today, even if you want to locally create, it is not easily possible, right? So there is an enormous amount of opportunity and having a digital platform like Shikshalokam remove the barriers for collaboration, because there are many barriers for collaboration. There is a physical barrier, there is a language barrier, there is a context barrier, and something like Shikshalokam, which is fully digital, is available throughout, removes the barriers for collaboration. And that is exactly what we are seeing now, right? We are seeing. So in Punjab, for example, I think some of our elementaries are created a collective, which is a great example of collaboration to achieve the same goals, right? See, I always believe that the intellectual property of an organization is in its capability to execute, not in the PPTs and the processes we create. A lot of people think, this is my PPT, this is my intellectual property, I will keep it with me. I tell them, boss, PPTs anybody can create, but to execute is very hard. So the intellectual property is in execution. So you can collaborate on the PPT. You can't collaborate much on the execution because locally you are there. So people need to rethink how they see, how they view their core competencies and intellectual property.
Okay. Thank you so much. So due to limited time, I think we'll take one last question. And that is, how can young entrepreneurs stay motivated in these times and keep their teams motivated?
So I think, as I said, the leadership is about being calm at difficult times. I remember Mr. Murthy once telling me, Shibu, when one child is sick, the parent cannot panic because the other child will also panic.
Yeah.
It's a good example, right? Because I was having some very tough situation, and I, Mr. Murthy was my mentor when I was at Infosys for all kinds of things. And I was having some tough situation, and Mr. Murthy said, Shibu, and I was trying to, you know, look little hassled. And he said, Shibu, please remember, as a leader, if one child is sick, you cannot panic because the other child will also start panicking. So the leader's job is to make sure that you keep your head high. You be firm and focus on your focus on your objectives and make sure that you remain focused in tough times. Also, there is a saying which says, "This shall also pass."
Yes, sir.
This shall also pass. Remember that. This shall also pass. So, as long as you can remain firm, you can remain focused, you can remain calm, you can remain objective, one should be able to go through these difficult times. And the as leaders, you have no luxury. You don't have the luxury of being disenchanted or hassled or disappointed, because it's your job to keep the motivation high. Your job to and we have seen n number of crises. Actually, I have a speech tomorrow thinking about it. We have seen n number of crises, not at this scale, but we have seen other crises in the past: economic crisis, unemployment, wars, all kinds of things. We have come through many of them. In fact, we'll come through this. And when you come through this, I believe there will be a lot more new innovation which will happen, because every time when the humanity is faced with a huge crisis, right, if you look at the results of Second World War, which is all negative, but you have the atomic power, you have enormous improvements in air travel, you name it. So similarly, when you come out of this, I think there will be enormous amount of opportunities and large amount of innovations which will happen.
Yes, sir. Definitely. I totally resonate with that. And so, because there are a lot of questions which are flowing, I would just like to take one last question, and I promise this is the last question. So the question is, how can civil society organizations secure themselves financially in the trying times ahead?
So this is a time for everyone to tighten their belt a bit, whether you are in civil society, whether you are in business, you need to make sure that you are very frugal at this point in time, because every resource is stretched, right? So there are certain expenses which are not there today, because I see that all my organizations, the travel expenses become zero. The number of expenses have become suddenly. So, and at the same time, the people who are, you need to also remember saying that the people who are supporting you are also going through a tough time. Yeah. They're also going through a tough time. I believe that the people who truly believe in your cause will continue to support. Right? The alignment of objectives and cause becomes very important, because in tough times, what the person who supports will do is to try and align himself to the organizations where there is a clear alignment between his objectives and your objectives. So it is very important to make sure that you remain transparent, you remain aligned to the objective of the supporting organization, and you are very clear on your impact. You show impact is the one which will energize the support. And at the same time, remain very, very frugal, because the resources are really, really stretched. All around, we ourselves had to divert resources from our, in one place to another because food packet delivery and other things, which we did, which means that we diverted resources from one place to another, right? So the focus on preserving resources and being very, very frugal, focus on impact, making sure that you are aligned with the set of people who are supporting you. I think these are the three things which comes to my mind.
Definitely. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for answering those questions. And thank you so much for taking our time out of your busy schedule and sharing these insights with our audience today. Over time, the ecosystem is realizing the various opportunities this crisis has highlighted, and your words have just reiterated the confidence amongst organizations to move forward with optimism and constantly innovate in their approach.